In this video, we're going to look at Le Chatelier's principle and how to conquer it using simplified guidelines. Before we talk about Le Chatelier's principle, let's first get to know what it means by a system that is in dynamic equilibrium. Let's take a simple reaction consisting of two reactants, let's say A and B. They combine to form a complex, say AB. We'll call this reaction the forward reaction. Now, if that AB complex split up to form back A and B, that will be the reverse reaction because AB reverses back to A and B. Putting these two reactions into one equation will look like this. We use the equilibrium arrow to represent the reversible reaction. The reaction is called reversible since A and B can combine to form AB, and at the same time, AB can break up to form back A and B. Now, when A and B combine to form AB complex at the same rate as the complex splitting up to give back A and B, the system is said to be in equilibrium. Since the system is constantly moving, meaning A and B are constantly forming AB, while AB complex is constantly breaking down to A and B, that makes the system dynamic. That's what it means by a system is in dynamic equilibrium. Once a system reaches dynamic equilibrium, and something happens to the system will respond by increasing either the forward or the reverse reaction in order to get back to equilibrium. What could possibly happen though? Well, it could be something like increasing or decreasing the concentration of a substance in the reaction, heating or cooling the entire system, or changing the pressure or the volume of the reaction vessel. In this video, I'll refer to this type of changes as stress on the system. Let's look at how the system will respond to each of these stress. Our first stress is concentration. So where will the equilibrium shift to if concentration of a substance X is increased? Well, it will shift to the side of the reaction that doesn't have X. Whereas if concentration of X is decreased, then it will shift to the side that has X. Important note to know is that this shift is not applicable when the substance is pure solid or liquid, meaning adding or removing a liquid or solid from a system at equilibrium will have no effect on the position of the equilibrium, so there will be no shift. Now, this guideline works regardless of whether substance X is a reactant or a product. So let's use an example to illustrate how this works. So we have a reaction right here, it's in equilibrium. If we increase the concentration of H2O gas, meaning steam, then the equilibrium will shift to the side that doesn't have H2O, which means it will shift to the right. Now, if we do the opposite, meaning if we decrease the concentration of H2O, then it should shift to the side that has H2O, meaning the equilibrium will shift to the left-hand side. Like I mentioned just now, this guideline works regardless of where X is, reactant or product. Since H2O is a reactant, let's just use an example that is a product, CO. So let's do the same thing, let's increase the concentration of CO gas. Now because CO is on the right hand side, and if we increase, equilibrium will shift to the side that doesn't have X, which means equilibrium will now shift to the left hand side. And remember earlier when I mentioned that this is not applicable to pure solid and liquid, so if we have something like increasing the concentration of carbon, so maybe like adding more carbon solid to the reaction, will there be any equilibrium shift? No, because carbon is solid, right? So there will be no change to the equilibrium shift. Let's move on to stress number two, temperature. If we increase the heat on the system, the temperature increases, and the equilibrium will shift to the side that doesn't have heat. If we decrease the temperature, then obviously it will shift to the opposite side, which is the side that has heat. And again, this guideline is universal, be it whether the reaction is endothermic or exothermic. You'll see what I mean later with an example. This reaction has an enthalpy which is positive 131.28 kilojoules. The positive value means that it's an endothermic reaction, which means we can rewrite this equation and then we'll place the heat, 131.28, on the left-hand side as part of the reactant. If the reaction is exothermic, meaning delta H is negative, we'll then add in that heat value on the right-hand side. So, if we were to increase the temperature, that means we heat up the system, what will happen? The equilibrium will shift to the side that doesn't have heat. So, since 131.28 is on the left-hand side, the equilibrium should shift to the right-hand side. Similarly, if we were to reduce the temperature, that means we cool down the reaction vessel, and then now what will happen is the equilibrium will shift to the side that has heat. So that would be on the left hand side. Moving on to the third stress, which is pressure. If we increase the pressure on the system, then equilibrium will shift to the side that has lesser gas molecules. If we decrease the pressure on the system, then equilibrium will shift to the side that has more gas molecules. Sometimes you may encounter that the question mentions volume instead of pressure. When we talk about volume, we are referring to increasing or decreasing the volume of the reaction vessel, like a closed round bottom flask or anything that houses the reaction. Note that we are not referring to increasing or decreasing the volume of the gas molecules in a reaction. So recall that pressure and volume are inversely proportional according to Boyle's law. That means if the stress is increasing the pressure on the system, that actually means decreasing the volume of the reaction vessel. And if the stress is decreasing the pressure, that actually means increasing the volume of the reaction vessel. So all you have to do is convert the stress from pressure to volume, and then you can easily use this guideline to help you determine the equilibrium shift. Let's use an example to see the impact of pressure or volume on the equilibrium. If we increase the pressure on the system or reduce the volume of the reaction vessel, then the equilibrium will shift to the side that has lesser gas molecules. Now, what does that mean? Well, let's look at our reaction and we will count how many moles of gas molecules we have on each side of the reaction. On the left-hand side, we have one H2O. On the right-hand side, we have one H2 and one CO. Again, we are only counting the gas molecules. So that means on the left-hand side, we have one mole of gas, and on the right-hand side, we have two moles of gas. So referring back to the table, when we increase pressure, it will shift to the side that has lesser gas. In our example, left-hand side has lesser gas, so that means our equilibrium shift will go to the left. Now, if we decrease the pressure, meaning increase the volume of the reaction vessel, then the equilibrium will shift to the side that has more gas. So that means in this example, it's going to shift to the right-hand side because right-hand side has more gas molecules. Sometimes you'll encounter questions that ask you on the equilibrium shift when catalyst or inert gas is added. Just note that there is no impact on the equilibrium shift because when we add catalyst, it will affect the rate on the forward and the reverse reaction. It will just make the reaction go faster on both sides. It doesn't change the concentration of the reactants and the products, so meaning it will not cause any stress to the system like what we've seen with concentration, temperature, or volume or pressure, so there will be no shift to the equilibrium. The same thing goes with adding inert gas, meaning gas that will not react to a reaction. If we add the inert gas at constant pressure, it will lower the concentration of all gases in the reaction, both the reactants and products, meaning it will not cause any imbalance to the equilibrium. Therefore, there will also be no change to the equilibrium. With that, we have gone through how the system will respond to stresses such as concentration, temperature, volume, or pressure, as well as catalyst and inert gas. If you find these guidelines helpful, do give a thumbs up, do subscribe, and thanks for watching.